I want to start by thanking Vittorio and the GUE for organising this important conversation. I want to also thank all of the speakers because I certainly I've learned a lot. I think if we have learned nothing else today, we can learn that poverty makes you sick, privatisation makes it worse, and the only cure is decent, publicly funded health services. Health is big, big business. This is a fact. It is becoming more so. It is, as we learn to try to cope with an ageing population, we see private interests move into the public space more and more. Prior to being elected to the Irish Parliament, I worked as a full-time trade union organiser. I represented workers in the healthcare sector for over a decade. I represented workers at all grades: nurses, radiographers, home health, porters, theatre assistants. Every person, bar doctors, within the health service came within my trade union. It was the largest, is the largest trade union in Ireland. I was also a member of the Public Services National Committee of the Irish Congress of Trade Unions, and we would have negotiated directly with government. On good days, we negotiated for pay increases. During the economic crash, we were left in the situation where we were negotiating pay cuts and cutbacks, and no trade union official ever wants to be there. In 2009, when the economic crash and the banking crisis hit very, very hard in Ireland, as I know it did elsewhere, the government moved very swiftly to impose a moratorium on recruitment. This halted all recruitment. And it was easy to do it because at the time there was a media storm of attacks on public servants and on their working conditions and their pension entitlements. Now, I've never made any apology for defending decent work, but in 2009, those of us who did so were absolutely vilified in the press. We were treated disgracefully. I opened the newspaper one morning and I saw a picture of myself with the words beside it: "This is the face of the woman who wants to shut down Ireland." Another headline: "Here are the people who want to cripple our country." So that's how we were portrayed. That's what people said about us. That was the climate that was created, and that was the climate we were operating in at that time. So it served the interest, clearly, that climate. It served the interest of the right-wing government. It suited them that civil servants, public servants, and the people that represented them would be vilified, would be attacked, and would be discredited, because then they could make us the scapegoats for the banking collapse, the scapegoats for the economic crash which visited our country, while those who were responsible could sit back. They shoved the responsibility and the burden of coping with the financial crisis onto the backs of the people who could bear it the least, and those who caused it, and those who were well insulated because they were very rich, they got away scot-free. So, in effect, the government and the media created the climate that suits privatisation. So, firstly, they imposed the moratorium on recruitment. This happened in 2007, but it became entrenched in 2009. A blanket ban on recruitment, which in turn led to the cancellation of operations, the cancellation of appointments, the cancellation of treatment. And it led to the start of what we now call in Ireland the trolley crisis. So every day in Ireland, an average of 500 people wait overnight or for days to be admitted to hospital. So the doctor sees you in the emergency department, he or she tells you that you need to be admitted, and you wait, and you wait, and you wait for a bed. But you are on a corridor or in a bed, and you wait in an inappropriate location because you need a bed, but there are no beds. So we call that simply the trolley crisis. We've come to accept it now. 380 is a good day, 620 is a bad day, but it averages at around 500 people spend a day or more waiting to be admitted. Now, this is not unique to Ireland. I know that waiting in emergency departments is not unique, but waiting for days is unique within, I believe, within a European context. And it's not an accident. It is the direct result of government policy, and it creates the ideal climate for outsourcing and privatisation on a wholesale basis. So the moratorium was a very blunt instrument which was used, they said, to control the public sector pay bill. The government of the day decided that they would curb the recruitment in the health service first. They claimed that the pay bill was out of control and that there was what they referred to as a pensions time bomb. The truth, of course, was miles from this. Most workers in the health service earn very modest wages and as a consequence can expect to receive very modest pensions when they retire. In 2007, moving into 2009, we didn't know how bad this was going to get. We thought that we were actually having an industrial relations dispute with the government as the employer. But looking back on it now, I see that we weren't. In fact, we were involved in an ideological war with those neoliberal forces who saw an opportunity in the economic situation that Ireland was facing at the time. We took the employer, of course, through the usual industrial relations channels, and at every turn they pleaded poverty. They moved in 2009 to cut pay twice. And all the while, they were cheer-led by a willing media who chose to showcase the inefficiencies and the failings of the public health service, which we know were all caused by a lack of funding. They compared the long waits, the poor equipment, and the heavy reliance on paper files to the seeming efficiency of the private system, where no one has to wait, where all records are computerised. This was music to the ears of a population who had been drip-fed a diet of public sector bashing and who had been bought over to the notion that they needed to join with the government and oppose the greedy public servants and their representatives. This was a con. It was a massive con, and many now see it for what it was. But as we faced into the collapse of the property market, rising unemployment rates, the collapse of private pension schemes, and the virtual decimation of pay in the private sector, the view of the public service found a very willing audience, because people had been crucified by the economic downturn and they wanted somebody to blame. And it was very easy to point their fingers at public servants who had job security, who had pensions, who had a relatively decent workplace. So instead of blaming the bankers, the right-wing government forces, it was very easy to blame the porter or the nurse or the doctor, because they had job security and a decent pension. So when the health service was on its knees and demand for public service was rising along with the unemployment rate, we see the entry onto the scene of precarious work, and say I refer to that as well, you know, it's not new in Ireland, but previously our public service had always been a place where decent work was respected, where a job for life was not an alien concept. So I'd like to illustrate this, if I can, with just a very brief case study. A hospital in rural Ireland employing 35 cleaners, all on full-time permanent pensionable jobs. Because of the recruitment moratorium, they can't recruit any additional staff. Therefore, when staff retire or move on or are out on maternity leave or long-term sick leave, they're not replaced. And so hospital management are left with no option but to contract out part of the service. They prepare a tender and they go out to the private market. The workers resist, but they are in a climate, as I described, of extreme hostility created by the demonisation of public servants. So they threaten industrial action, but they know that without public support, they cannot win this battle. And reluctantly, they accept that some of the cleaning services will be contracted out because management simply can't recruit workers and there's more work than they can handle. Now, we all know that cleanliness and infection control are greatly enhanced by the continuity of staff, and this is not possible in an outsourced environment. However, that's a very hard argument to make when you're fighting for jobs. The same recruitment moratorium is in operation throughout this hospital, and by now it's 2011. The cleaners have taken 2 pay cuts and are working additional hours for free. They are short-staffed constantly. Management have a new idea. The kitchen too is short-staffed, they say, so management offered the cleaners work in the kitchen. Similar rates of pay, but marginally more attractive work. The cleaners, of course, take this work, and this leaves the cleaning unsustainable because the staff are transferring into the kitchen. Therefore, the cleaning service has to be outsourced because the moratorium means there can be no recruitment. So another tender is created, the cleaners now work in the kitchen, and the cleaning in the hospital is done by an outsourced company. The cleaners, of course, are now kitchen staff, but the problems faced by retirement, maternity leave and long-term sick leave still exist. Now, management have another idea. They will offer the kitchen staff work as healthcare assistants. This is better work again, and the staff who take it will not be replaced. Before too long, the provision of directly employed kitchen services also becomes unsustainable, and therefore this too must now be privatised. I saw this happen in hospital after hospital after hospital. The government created the problem for which the private sector had a ready-made solution. This kept the unions out, and the economic downturn ensured a ready supply of cheap and willing labour for the private contractors. While the private hospitals competed for who could offer the best room, the best food package, public hospitals were being run into the ground. Waiting lists were growing, and those people who depended on the public service were being let down repeatedly. In 2013, the government, under a minister from the Irish Labour Party, if you can believe that, established the Office of Government Procurement in order to make outsourcing and privatisation more efficient and more, I suppose, more importantly, quicker than it had been previously. And this happened all the while public servants were still being vilified and attacked in the media. And the Public Health Service was being derided at every turn. Nobody took account of the fact that in Ireland, no one is turned away from a public hospital. They take all comers, complex cases, unscheduled procedures, and chronic illnesses. Unlike their counterparts in the private system, who can cherry pick and who perform only planned procedures, the private system deals with those who, by their very nature, are in higher socioeconomic groups. They deal with those who are statistically less likely to be suffering from complications and ill health that we all know is caused by poverty and deprivation. And of course, they appear more efficient in those circumstances. They have been given every advantage. So while the public system takes all comers and turns no one away, those who may be suffering from not just ill health, those who are suffering from the complications that result as a direct result of deprivation. The project of privatisation was one which was enthusiastically embraced by public servants themselves because they believed some of the myths in the media. They believed that their own system was unworkable. They believed that their own system was inefficient. And many of those groups and categories believed that while they might outsource the cleaning, they might outsource the catering, they might outsource the security, they weren't going to outsource them. And of course, we all know that those who stood by and watched the cleaning and the catering get systematically outsourced are the same people now, several years later, who have realised that privatisation is a juggernaut and it stops for nobody and it drives around nobody. It keeps going and it will knock down any group of workers standing in its way. As I said, healthcare is big business. There's plenty of money to be made, especially in a climate where the population have been led to believe that the public health service is actually bad for your health. It's hardly surprising that in Ireland today, almost 50% of the population have private health insurance. There are over 700,000 of us on waiting lists. That's one in every six people is on a waiting list in Ireland at the moment. We have an average of 500 people per night waiting on trolleys. And we have a growing private healthcare industry. In Ireland, we subsidise the health service, which has a budget of just over 14 billion. Now, you ask our government and they'll tell you that's among the highest in Europe. Of course, it's not what you spend really, though, it's what you spend it on. But notwithstanding that 14 billion, we also subsidise, taxpayers subsidise the health service to the tune of another billion. From out-of-pocket expenses and from a subsidy that we pay to people to encourage them to get private health insurance. So if I want to attend a GP in Ireland tomorrow, it will cost me €55, which I think is pretty unique in a country that would pride itself on having a public health service. We pay over €2 million a week for agency staff. That goes up to 5 million, that's for nurses. That goes up to €5 million if you add in other grade groups and categories. And so this was the ideology that we were fighting back in 2007 to 2009. Some of us named it at the time and we were told that we were scaremongering. We pointed out that private healthcare provision rarely, if ever, represents good value for money. And we were told that we were anti-business and we were anti-competition and we needed to get with it and modernise, and that we were the reason that the health service was underperforming. And if you want to see this in action, you only have to look at a service like the Home Health Service. So Home Health Service started as a good neighbour service, a local woman might look in on an elderly person. It developed into a community-based service. The Home Helps working in Ireland today, if they are directly employed, cost the state about €16 an hour, all in. That includes everything. That includes holiday pay, sick pay, pension entitlements, everything. If you go to one of the global multinational corporations, they will charge anything up to €40 per hour for the same service. So when the Home Helps were fighting against the reduction in service on behalf of their clients, they said, no, we won't visit for less than half an hour. The private healthcare providers came in with their efficient, cost-effective model and they pushed the price of home care from €16 an hour up to €40 plus per hour. They offer a 15-minute call. For an elderly person, 15 minutes. To wash them, dress them, toilet them, make them comfortable, never mind have a chat or make a cup of tea. They offer a 15-minute service because that's how efficient they are. And when the Home Helps fought against that, they were told to get modern, get with it, and stop behaving like they were in the 16th century. Now, I've left the world of trade unionism for the world of full-time political activity, but I most definitely have not left the fight against privatisation. So those who colluded in running down the public service, they have won many, many battles, but they can't win the war. They simply can't. We cannot allow that to happen. And as I listen to the presentations here today, it's very, very clear. Big business and privatised companies have written the blueprint for how to come in and privatise our health service. It is up to us to write the blueprint for how we are going to resist that.